Going on, friends? How we doing? Welcome into the Zed Run Maiden stream. Part two. Is this the second one? I think this is the second one. Anyway, thanks for joining. We got a star-studded lineup tonight. We got High Horse Stables coming up first. And then Zodi's Racing, Sample Gate Stable, Dan Shan, Bellamy's Stable, and DK Racing. So it should be a fun night. All night tonight we're gonna be having the Zed Run, NASCAR, Zed Pass, Breed for Speed. This little deal is going on. So if you are a Zed Pass holder, you can. Let's see. How do I switch you over? There we go. All right. So if you're a Zed Pass holder, just keep in mind that your first time racing a horse is going to be eligible, or not your first time, but unraced horses. That's what I was trying to say. Eligible for the NASCAR promo here. So without further ado, we'll bring in Michelle from High Horse Stables joining us. Michelle, how are you doing?
Good. How are you?
Oh, fantastic. Fantastic. Thanks for joining us tonight.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah. So the way we do the show is you have a horse that you've bred that is unraced, and then I've got a whole bunch of donkeys lined up. I shouldn't say that. They're lovely horses. I breed with purpose, so... these should be decent. We'll see. So you go ahead and pick out a Griffin and we'll join it together. And okay. Then you can sort of, once we find the Griffin, you can talk through your breeding process and all that.
Sure. Let's see. I think I'm going to go with this 2600.
Wellington Cup?
Yep.
Okay. Perfect. So I'm going to throw in a horse here as well. All right. 12, I'll go 11. Oh, that's going to be confusing. Let's do this. Okay, cool. So in the chat, I'm going to start our first giveaway of the night real quick for all you... early risers here. I'm giving away all the horses that I raced tonight. So you've got 3 minutes in the chat to type !Zed and you'll be eligible to win. There are dozens of us, the horse that I just put into this race here. So Michelle, tell me about a sickening display, a Z6 Zabo exclusive.
So the parents are Lab Rat and Almost Even. I bred a horse, Orange Julia. It's my favorite horse. And she does pretty well. So I pretty much pair these two up every time since then. She was obviously pre, algo change. So,
yeah, I saw think... you had, was it Nova Star? Is that another?
Yeah.
How did that go?
So she's one of those ones that like flamed everywhere and would win everywhere, but not consistently enough to qualify, and then got stuck up in class one. So I'm kind of hoping it doesn't happen again, but it definitely could.
Yeah, that's the ultimate challenge here with the new version of with Discovery and all. So what have you found? You say you bred Orange Julia with these horses pre-algo. What have you noticed? What changes have you seen post-algo?
Like I just said, with that Nova Star one, I've gotten a lot of those, especially early on. I think we bred a lot of elites since then that don't always end up that way. I think we've been really trying to, you know, smash like RNG, high RNG together and match DP. I think that's where we found the most success.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. So is that is that what you did with this horse as well? They matched up Marathon DP?
Yeah. Yep.
Have you been going back and looking into like the second year like grandparents and stuff to match up to that level, or are you just looking specifically at parents at this point?
We look at grandparents too. I don't know if I've on like in our stable, I don't know if I've noticed like huge grandparent qualities popping up in the offspring. But I think we had Mysterious, which is a grandeur offspring. So I wanted to breed that, and we definitely didn't get anything like grandeur from it. So
And Mysterious has the long distance DP.
no, I think that's kind of like a sprinter. I don't know. It was really weird. I think it was a marathon like a long time ago, and then it started liking sprints. It's a weird one. So
Yeah.
but it's a very mediocre horse. I typically run it during pity, so and
Nice.
I think the offspring pretty much pulled from that.
Nice. So while we're waiting for this griffin to fill, and if
Yeah.
anybody in the chat has a 2600 meter you want to throw in here, so let's talk a little bit about your stable and the sort of the conglomerate that you guys have going. So I think it might be a good sort of structure for some people in the community that might have smaller stables that want to kind of team up and combine their resources. So can you talk a little bit about the origins of the High Horse stable?
Yeah, so I guess it started out like my husband bought a horse, and I was like, really? Like, what is this? What is this scam you're getting us into? But then, like, the second I saw a race, I was like, okay, this is definitely going to be something huge. And so then we bought another horse and another horse. And then one day my brother-in-law he hit us up and was like, Zook's saying he wants to like have people run his horses, or he wants to like merge his stable or something. Like, would you guys be interested in that? And I was like, yeah, for sure. So I think he made up this whole like PowerPoint presentation for Zook about how we're gonna like build out our stable and like just keep going and going until we can make it to the top. I mean, we're not at the top, but I think we're doing pretty well.
Yeah.
So and Zook liked it, and we immediately, I think that same day, he was like sending his horses over to us, and I was like, wow, this guy like trusts us with his horses like this. This is pretty cool. So
Yeah, had you guys met or just online relationship prior to?
yeah, just online so far. I think my brother-in-law met him at the RSOP meetup, I believe. I haven't met him yet in person. We're going to Saratoga, so we'll definitely see him then.
Nice.
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah, that's
Yeah.
super cool. I mean, it takes a lot of trust, but I guess with, and it's a specific case with someone like Zook that's out there all the time, but
Yeah.
it's definitely something to keep in mind for smaller stables. I know we got Sample Gates stable coming on in a little bit that is also a partnership, so I'm not sure what their story is. I'm looking forward to finding out, but all right, so we've got the giveaway is over. I'm gonna pick a winner so that you will know. Jungle Pony, congratulations, Jungle Pony. If you are in the chat, please post your wallet address, and I will send you this horse as soon as the stream is over. So hopefully Jungle Pony is around. Gotta be around. It was only 3 minutes ago. All right. So how many horses are you racing in the maiden today? What's your plan?
I know that I have two right now. We're not really big in the maiden. It's tough for us to keep horses unraced if
Right.
they're sitting there. It's especially for like 2 weeks now, like it's hard not to race them.
Yeah, for sure.
So this one we have, I have one more. I think we might have one other one, but I don't know if it's going to be any good. So
So tell me a little bit about your best breed so far with the post algorithm. What's
yeah.
worked best for you so far?
Well, so we created a little like side stable with heroin. So we did Dank and Phantom Pacer, and so far that one's been the beasts of the new breeds. Think it's up in class one now, and it's like flaming and coming in first and freeze mostly. So
So is that, did you match up distance preference on that horse as well, or was that just a situation where putting your two best horses together?
I'm not certain. I'm not sure what Phantom Pacer's DP is off the top of my head.
Yeah, I think he just wins everywhere.
It worked out. And
Nice.
then we also did Phantom Pacer with Ambassador, which is our Z1 mare, and that one's pretty good too.
Is that Phantom Agent?
Phantom
Okay.
Agent, and that one likes marathons, and Ambassador's a marathon, so
So then
they
what's your
actually both
plan?
do.
What's your plan with do you have sort of a long-term breeding strategy with the Heroine stable? Are you guys going like multiple tiers down? Do you planning on doing any inbreeding down the line?
Yeah, I think we're that is the plan, in breeding. We're just taking, our legendaries and exclusives that we get from our best horses and just breeding them down, and hopefully, getting some beasts later in the game.
Yeah, I mean that seems to be, if the breeding algorithm works the way they say, bringing in grandparents and that from time to time, you would think that that's the way to go, the way to
Yeah,
be
definitely.
successful. But nice. So, in case you guys missed it, Avon Fields just did a 24-hour charity stream for Little Wishes. Just ended a few hours ago, so he's definitely sleeping at this point. But if you guys want, the donation wallet, pretty sure, is still open. So you can head over to Twitter, HerbieHerb42, and you can send donations. They also have a stable with some horses. I'm not sure if that's still going, but they were auctioning off some horses. So it's a great cause if you want to go and check that out, get involved. But more importantly, join this damn griffin. What's going on here, folks? Trying to keep on a schedule tonight, and this griffin is making me nervous with
I
race number one.
think there's only one spot left.
Yeah, we're 11 of 12, so if we can get somebody in the chat, man, I might have to just start firing out horses from other stables. So what's your general thoughts about Zed overall right now? I know there's a lot of sort of fear in the community and uncertainty. How are you guys feeling as a stable?
I'm not scared personally. I love Zed. I see such a big future for it. I don't know how long it's gonna take. I don't know what changes they're gonna make, but I know that it's exciting. And there's always days where you're just kind of like fuck this game. Like I need a break. But I think like that's the thing is like people don't take breaks and then they end up like hating Zed,
Right. Yeah, the
and it's like
burnout
you
is
need to
real.
take a break because I mean like we run all day every day, so eventually, like especially after like a really hard day of qualifying and then you just get like nothing out of the tournament,
Right.
you're just like, oh man, like I literally just wasted that whole day. But I still enjoy it, we got into this game knowing that there was going to be changes, not knowing what the changes would be. Like it's in beta, so I understand that, and like I understand why people would want to leave too, but I can't imagine my life without Zed, so
Yeah.
I'm here for the long haul.
Yeah. No, I'm with you. I'm way too far down this rabbit hole
Yeah.
to look back at this point.
Right.
So we got flames for a sickening display, which is a
Nice.
good sign. Also got flames from DK Racing with a Z36 Butte Buff Biscuit. Love to see that. And then a Z24 Butte 7 in slow-mo with flames. So looking like you can expect flames. There's actually a couple of Z4s, Z8. Flames aren't Yeah, flames are a little unexpected here. What do you make from taking a flame? What are you expecting out of this race? Seeing that you flamed against some lower tier, not I hesitate to say lower tier, but you know, like bred Buterins, a little deeper down the genotype. So
Yeah.
what kind of what are you expecting based on historical performance?
I mean, obviously I want to win. But like I honestly think the Griffins are a complete crapshoot for the most part. 'Cause you really don't know. Like you could be racing a marathon and it likes a sprint, but it pulls flames 'cause it's got high BA. You know, you don't know. I for discovery, I like to run every single distance. Even if I win, I just like to know, you know, what it's going to do in the other distances before I go into, you know, the classes. I
So
like to know.
even on like a maiden day like today where the tournament's going on, will you keep hammering the marathons for five races, or are you just going to run it like it's any other day?
So I think what my plan's going to be is I'll run it in this is a 26, right? So then I'll probably do a 24 and a 22, and if it does well, then I'll do another two marathons. And then I'll, you know, if I qualify, I'll wait. If not, then I'm just going to go, I'll do some you know, probably a 1000 and a 1200. I'll probably do a 14, 16 and 18 and probably skip the 2000.
Nice. All right. Well, let's take a look at these other two flaming horses real quick just to see what's going on. Seven and slow-mo. Is this going to be as obvious as the name implies? Yep. Slow-mo. Meant for seven. Interesting breed. And then we've got Buff Biscuit from DK Racing, who DK Racing is going to be coming up on the show later. And just in the chat showing off a little bit. Open Sea Biscuit and Buff Kelly. So a couple of solid bred horses there. It's interesting.
I like to see that.
Yeah.
I think it's cool when you see like these like Z36 Buterin elites. Like that's awesome that they're pulling flames over like a Z4 Knock. Like I mean, obviously it stinks for the Z4 Knock. You don't want to see that, but I don't know, it's cool. I like that.
Yeah, no, I know personally. I breed a bunch of garbage in my stable, and I, before the algorithm change, I never had anything good below a legendary Bute. And now there's, I've had quite a few exclusive and elite Buterins that are, I mean, nothing great, but definitely better than what I was getting before, just because I can smash the DP together with a little bit of purpose and
Right.
get that going. So, man, that was a Genesis Buterin in gate nine. That's interesting. Dusting off the Genesis for the maiden tournament. And there's also a Gen. I don't know if it's actually. It might not still be going. But there was a Genesis Butte package giveaway with the charity stream. So, again, go check out Herbie Herb on Twitter. And if you can sign up for that, you have to donate some money to the Little Wishes charity. So, check that out. All right, here we go. We are running. We got a name that just doesn't translate well to these characters. So Hall Runner. We got Majestic Vibes. Got Zone. Seven in Slow Mo. Agent Cody Banks. Good Horse Name. Buff Biscuit. Melissa Lane. New Wave. Speedball. There are dozens of us. And a sickening display. Gate 12 from High Horse Racing. And again, we've got Jungle Pony, who's taken home There Are Dozens of Us tonight, a Z34 Finny Cross. And Jungle Pony, it doesn't look like you put your wallet address in the chat yet. So if you wanted to do that so that I can send this guy over to you later, that would be delightful. So are you a 2D or 3D race watcher?
You know, I used to be 3D, but I've been doing 2D a lot. It's just quicker.
Yeah, no, I'm with you. And my main computer that I use can't really handle the 3D graphics anyway, so it's all glitchy all the time. So,
Yeah.
yeah, I'm
I
a.
feel like half the time I like pull up a 3D race, I end up like waiting for it to go, and then I end up missing it anyway. So.
Yeah, I know. I'm a big fan of the 2D.
Yeah.
Big fan. So we got Sohail out in front. New Wave is gonna catch him in just a second here. Buff Biscuit's coming up quick, and a sickening display has broken in the 12 gate. And I'm sure there are dozens of us is coming up quick shortly here. Here he comes. All right, is that a filly or a filly? Sorry, there are dozens of us. Here she comes. Looks like a sickening display. Might have enough to take this. We got 500 meters to go. Buff Biscuit out in front, but a sickening display is pacing the field pretty well here. So what do we make of this? I hesitate to call it a result, but I think we all know what's going to happen here. What do you make of this win here?
Yeah, I'm gonna run it in marathons for
All right. Yeah, I mean,
Yeah.
with the maiden in mind, obviously, if it wasn't a maiden day, would you just, even though it's a win on your, flaming a win is, you know, the best start you can hope for,
Oh, yeah.
would you just continue on, just power through as though just you're getting data?
Personally, I would. I know Zook doesn't like doing that. My husband doesn't like doing that either. But for me, I like to get all the data in Discovery, which even still, it doesn't necessarily translate over once it's in the regular class system, because I've had horses that didn't pull a flame in Discovery, and then it landed in probably like class three, and then it's like pulling flames in a 1400. I mean, it's still
Right.
a crap horse. Like, it's not gonna win. Like,
Right.
it might win, but it's not enough. So, but I do like to gather the data. I mean, it's discovery because it's like you're discovering what your horse can do. That's how I see it.
Totally. Cool. Well, before we let you go, any last thoughts or anything you want to contribute before we get on to Hawkward?
No, I think that's it. Thanks for having me.
Awesome. Yeah, no problem. Well, let's jump back here and we will push some buttons on the back end to do that and do that. All right, here we go. We got Hawkward coming in. So from Zodi's Racing. Shoot, this is on the wrong side. I'm gonna switch you again. Here we go. There she is.
Hey.
Welcome in. How are you?
Thanks. I'm good. How are you?
I am doing fantastic. We are only a couple minutes behind after our first guest, and I've got faith that the chat is going to help us and Philly's race a little bit quicker.
Yeah, we can go for something like shorter too. Like, let's see if there's a sprint available.
Perfect. Yeah, let's check out Discovery here and see what we've got. You're looking for a sprint. You've got a horse. Well, we'll talk about your horse in a second
Yeah,
here.
yeah.
We got a 1200 with six spots and a
Sure.
1000 with seven open spots. What do you think?
Let's go with the 1200. How about?
Okay, cool.
Hopefully we don't get front run. Oh, great. All right, I'm in.
Nice.
Okay.
I'm in as well. All right. So chat, here we go again. Just giving away, as DK Racing in the chat says, we are giving away some premium names tonight. So the horses may not run well, but if you're ever able to sell names, you got some gold coming out tonight. So Swaggletooth is on the board. Exclamation point Zed in the chat if you're interested. Okay, so Hawkward, welcome. We got
Thanks.
Hoddle to Zero, a
Yeah.
Z19 Finney Elite. Let's hear about your horse.
Yeah. So basically, I was just trying to get more females in my stable. So I actually like bought a mare
for this, Count Zero. I'm trying to get more into class one. I started from like really bad horses, so I'm slowly adding to the stable, hopefully get to a more competitive level. But yeah, so JPEG Problem was a horse that I bred. It was the first one that I bred with Dan Chan's help and Blood Tool. And you know, it originally said it had a really high base ability, and then Blood Tool updated to like much lower. So we'll see what we get out of it. It could be a complete donkey. But you know, the name's inspired by the recent market crash and like cryptocurrency like drama that's been happening.
I love it. Love it. So, you said you just bought Count Zero. Is this the first breed that you've done with Count Zero?
Yeah, so that's the first one I got out of Count Zero, but I'm really liking that horse so far. It's nice to be able to run in class one and actually get something out of it. But
Yeah. So what was it that you saw in Count Zero that made you buy this horse?
I was kind of leaning on Blood Tool pretty heavily, just looking at like the RNG base ability and then the distance preference for me. It seemed to match up with the JPEG problem pretty well, but I may have made a mistake. Like, it may be, since it's so lightly raced in mid distances, it may actually, you know, be good there. I don't know. I have to like figure that out. But I'm a very impulsive breeder, so I literally just be like, I want to breed a horse, and then I go and like find something that matches whatever I have available in stud and stuff. So
Yeah, no, it's I'm very similar. Although I just
yeah.
breed with my own stuff. I don't stray out much. All
Yeah, I'm
right,
gonna
so
have to
here we
put
go.
a like a hard limit of like, okay, now I'm gonna like only breed with profits I got because
Yeah,
it's
that's a
very
very
easy.
yeah, budgets in Zed
Oh,
Run, very
hey, we got
important. We got flames, HODL to zero. Off to a good start with the flame.
flames.
Swaggletooth again, must be a sprinter. I must have written it down wrong here again. But again, in the chat, we got Swaggletooth. We're giving away. Type exclamation point Zed, and yeah, you're gonna love it. So, Hawkward, tell me a little bit more about your breeding strategy pre and post algorithm. I think, did you take a little break from Zed there for a while?
I'm kind of, I do Zed in waves when I get like bored or stressed out from like the main crypto community. I kind of like focus on Zed Run. And so I'm back in another cycle because like the main like NFT community is kind of just like panicking right now. So I'm like, all right, let's do some more Zed. But Mike, you were on Avon's stream last night, and your strategy that you went over is pretty similar to me. It's like I love like finding these horses that seem like hidden gems. Like maybe they look crappy, but they're like not super raced in one distance, and just like figuring out like, oh, maybe I have something like there. And usually it's not the case, of course, but I just
Yeah,
love.
it's not a great that is my strategy. It's not a great one. I gotta be
No,
honest.
yeah,
It's
you know,
not
it's
very
not a good
successful.
strategy for like profit, but it's a good strategy for fun because I'll just
It's true.
like
Yeah.
sit there and just like think about like all the data and stuff, like you know, that gif of like all the like figures floating
Yeah,
around your head, but it's like horses. So,
for
yeah,
sure.
my breeding strategy before was yeah, like smash whatever horses I had available together, and now I'm trying to do like a little more intuitive, like they say they want to reward players for like breeding more smart. And I do have access to Blood Tool, which is really cool, but I also want to like go in with that beginner mindset of like, like say I didn't have Blood Tool, like can I make decisions based on just what Zed gives me and be like, okay, these two horses are good at sprinting. Let's put them together, see what happens. So it's kind of like a mix, you know, I'm always experimenting.
Yeah. So what have you found so far in the last couple of cycles? What's your best outcome and what
I've found that I'm really not good at breeding, but before the breeding change, I have gotten lucky with a couple of lotto ticket horses where I put together two like not that great horses and got something with like crazy RNG. And Yeah, that's Lesbian Pride, and that's the one that I did all my downclassing in the tournament today for Avon's thing. It was like a U-shaped tourney, so I was like, all right, she's in class one and she's like 100% down class, so let's go. But yeah, right now, like, I'm trying to like honestly breed less, but I just can't help myself sometimes, so it's just like whenever a horse is available, I just see what I can put with it, you know.
Nice. I apologize, chat. I think I fucked up the giveaway. Everybody's just typing exclamation point Z and nothing's happening.
Oh
'Cause I didn't complete the previous giveaway. It's an important step. You gotta finish the previous giveaway before you start the next one. So, exclamation point Z in the chat now. Sorry about that, guys. So we got
right.
HODL to zero over here in gate 10. So it's a little late for me to say all the horses, but that's okay. You guys can watch the replay
What?
later.
There are dozens of us. That's a reference to something. What is that?
That is an Arrested Development,
Oh yeah.
never nude reference.
Yeah. I love that show.
Yeah.
It's like I that's familiar. It sounds familiar.
It's something. Yeah, all my horses are something. All right, HODL to zero is climbing, but not looking like it's gonna be strong
Ooh.
enough.
No.
Yeah, that's a middle of the pack finish, but it's looking like this is a strange race.
Dang.
Flames are pretty well distributed
Oh,
through
he's tanking
the field.
actually, I think. All right.
Yeah. So what? Where are we here? We got flames and a 12th, ironically with a win and no flame. So that's great. A purple wombat, HODL zero got 8th, and Swaggletooth is obviously a long distance horse, so that's great.
Yeah, it might be better than mine. We'll see.
Okay, so flames and an 8th. What do we take from this?
I like the flame. I'll take the flame and eighth place. I'm not gonna sweat it. We'll see. You know, it'll
Yeah.
be good in class four maybe if it isn't good at anything else. But I
So the
appreciate you
so
having me
this
on.
yeah, oh no, absolutely. So this was a 1200 meter. Where are you headed next in Discovery? Are you gonna go 1200 again since it pulled a flame? Or are you gonna try 1000 or 14?
I'm gonna try mid because both of the parents might actually accidentally be mids that like I
Okay.
didn't like race enough. So we'll see if
Interesting.
it's secretly a mid horse.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, you know.
Nice. Do you want to? We got a few minutes. You want to find a mid and jump in? See what's going on.
Yeah, and I
What's
mean I
your? Is that? Are you? Do you have a few horses you're racing in the maiden tournament tonight? I saw you were on the track last night with BIYC Batty. Beat
Yeah.
me a couple times.
I have quite a good like assortment this round. I was like, oh, let's go for it. Last hurrah, I guess, of breeding before I like close off any like inflow of cash to my wallet. But yeah, like I can do another Griffey or I can do another distance. It just depends if you're waiting on someone.
Okay.
But
Well, we got one of our two sample gates people in the background. So, yeah, we can just talk a little bit more about sort of your general going forward, your Zed co kind of Zed outlook. How are you feeling about? You said you play Zed in waves.
Yeah.
Are we on a good wave right now? How are you feeling about things?
It's a good wave. Like I know the game is still kind of not complete, but the way I see it is like you know, it's kind of just like a puzzle with a few pieces missing, and they're just you know, it's really gonna be kind of broken until everything comes together, especially with like the token launch. Like I feel like a lot of complaints about profitability, you know, they're valid. They're very valid complaints, but I hope that they'll change once the token comes into play and like free race grinding has a bit more rewards to it. But you know, you never know how much of that's wishful thinking or not.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I'm hopeful. I'm hopeful. Okay, let's pick a winner real quick before we let you go. We've got Swaggletooth, the Z, what are you? Z22 Finny Elite. And the winner is Willie Rover. Congratulations, Woo. Willy Rover. If you could paste your wallet address in the Twitch chat, we will get you that horse. All right. Well, Hawkward, it's been a pleasure. Thank you for joining us tonight, and best of luck with HODL to Zero in the mid-funnel.
Thanks for having me. I look forward to just kind of relaxing after, you know, being up late with Kyle last night. So
yeah, right?
I'll just kind of chill and watch the rest of the stream.
There you go. Thanks. Awesome. Cool, man. Well, sorry, I say cool, man, all the time.
it's okay.
It's my one of those mannerisms or whatever. Anyway, been a pleasure. Thanks for joining us.
Bye.
I will remember you. Will you remember me?
All right. We are bringing in the fellas from Sample Gates Stable as we pay our respects to the great John Lee.
That was funny.
We miss you, John. If you're watching from wherever you are, you know, thanks. Sorry that we fudded you to death. All right, so Sample Gates Stable is joining us now. Gentlemen, we haven't had the opportunity to talk before, so why don't you take a moment to introduce yourselves?
Sure, I'll go first. Yeah, we're joint stable, so happy to tell our story. I'm Brendan, this is Eric. We go back and forth on Twitter. You almost never know who it is or who's on the track, but if it's on the track, it's normally Eric. We went to high school with two other buddies that were in NBA Top Shot. I stumbled across a Zed Run, I think from Darren Rovell, and texted my buddies and said, hey, you guys wanna buy a virtual horse? And it's been a good way. We're all in different parts of the country to stay in touch and kind of do it together. So it's been fun.
Nice. So is it just the two of you guys, or are there others in the stable as well?
We do all the work. So we took some money from our buddies, but it's mostly just Eric and I. Yeah, I'd say it's two-man stable.
Nice. So what about you, Eric? Did Brendan get you in, or what's your story?
Yeah, that was pretty much it. Was I think we were all just like sitting around one night, and Brendan sent a text and said, do y'all want to buy a virtual racehorse? And I think everyone said yes before we knew, like before we even like looked at anything. So then that started like, I don't know, it was a few hour like quick dive into Zed, and then setting everything up, moving everything around. And then unfortunately we pulled the trigger on pretty bad horse, but I think that's pretty normal.
Yep. So rite of passage.
Yeah. So
nice. So tonight you guys are racing a Z25 Zabo cross named Shadow the Hedgehog. Is that still the plan?
Do you believe it is?
Excellent. So tell us about this horse.
Yeah, so that horse is, I'm gonna pull it up real quick so I don't forget anything about the horse.
We could have just
run. There's a bunch of numbers. It's easy to get confused.
Yeah.
You know, like run a low Z7. We won our first Griffey of the night, which is exciting, but we thought it'd be more interesting to talk about something that was a little bit more strategic when you get to the cross level. So go ahead, Eric.
Yeah. So this horse is basically, we've been looking through, or our first couple of like tests were just like, smash together DP on DP, pretty straightforward, see what you end up with. I think generally what everyone said before, which is like, it's just about the average of the horses, seems to be about right. What is interesting is that the father of the horse, this horse that we bred, did turn out to be better than both the mother and the father. So we were fairly interested in that horse just because we of all of the horses that we just kind of bred together with DP on DP, that was I think the first one that we tried that had like all four grandparents, or like three out of four of the grandparents had the same distance preference. And so that's sort of how we started continuing down this line is, let's see what happens when we start getting into the cross level of like eight grandparents that are sprinters, or obviously not eight, but yeah. Huge line of sprinters on one side. We ended up with a really strong DP. And then when we go to the other side, we have, I'd say, a couple of solid racers, some interesting blood on that line. If I recall correctly, that side goes up to
Stylish Criminal from Know Your Horses, I think.
Yeah, on one side. And then
so have you guys been kind of going out of your way to look deeper into the DP to the grandparents and great grandparent level when you choose your breedings?
Not quite enough. I think we could be even better at it because I do think it matters. And like Eric said, Hattie Haddington was our maiden horse, and that's about the most clean bloodline we have in stable that we bought pre-algo, where both grandparents are, it's all sprinters all over the place. And it turns out, I know Dan Shan, he's coming on later, pulled up his blood tool rankings, and it was like Hattie has the strongest distance preference of any horse. And it's flaming in C1 and it's winning C2 paids when neither parent can. So
wow.
I definitely think there's a key. One of the most interesting tidbits from Kyle's stream for the Fuck Cancer yesterday came from PK Alhambran. And I think I'm on board with it to some effect that if you match perfectly distance preference between two horses, there's a chance that you can exceed the parents, whether it pulls in from grandparent, whether it gives you some type of boost to BA. Our two best breeds out of, I'd say, 15 post-algo was not only matching distance preference, but like back within the line, either having a strong racer or that exact same distance, not just funnel, but like specific distance is kind of what we're going with right now.
Interesting. All right, so let's hop over and find a Griffin. Looks like we got a few available. Are you guys looking for what's the distance you're ideally looking for here?
We're hoping for a 1,000. Might be willing to take 1,200.
Okay, looks like on this one 12 with a couple of spots. You want to jump in?
Three spots left. Yeah, let's get in there.
What gate are you going for?
Let's see. What do we got? I'll take 9. Let's see if we can get it.
All right, chat. Let us in here. Uh-oh, that was quick. Did you guys get in?
Uh-oh, I think we did.
I think I did too. Are we all in?
Yeah, we're in.
All right, we're in. Okay, so real quick before we talk about the race, I got Dear John in the race here, and I'm giving him away. So type !Z in the chat if you want to take home Dear John. So fellas, we no flame. What do we take from that?
Not too much. Would have been nice to get the flames, but we were hoping here to pass down variants from the mother onto just the distance preference of father. So no flames in a 1200. If it's variable like the mother, then not super concerned about it, or if it just has a better time in the 1000, I think that will take either a first or kind of a bad finish here.
Yeah, what's your ideal outcome knowing that it's probably, or you hope it's a sprinter, but it didn't get a flame? What's sort of best case, worst case scenario here?
I want a top three. You know, again, not the end of the world, but getting outflamed by Z13 and Z18 Buttes if we're in the right funnel isn't ideal, so I'm a little disappointed. Because even if it does you, right, it's not like we have a ton of killers that we know of, right? But that's the crazy part about Griffins now is, and I could go on my pedestal about breeding 1.0 and 2.0, and I think there's pros and cons in both. Everybody's a little too absolute of, you know, which one's better and the other one's awful. But, right,
which one do you think is awful?
Neither. I'm very neutral and...
No, you have... If this is said, you have to think something is awful.
Breeding 2.0 has been way better than us because it rewards better racers rather than lower Zs. And we don't have a huge budget for our stable. We kind of bred some diamonds in the roughs, got lucky. You know, pre-algo, low Zs, but when you turn that over and bred it in breeding 1.0, Zedj, Dan Shan, all the smart breeding people that are way smarter than us could almost tell you the drop in base ability when you go from Genesis to Legendary to Exclusive in breeding 1.0 right. And 2.0, right? That's the thing is I think you can no longer look at this field and say, oh, we got outflamed by, you know, two Buterins, because people are coming up with these crosses like DK, right? Where the 37 cross is going to flame over some Z4s now, where breeding 1.0, I know there was more lottos to get the extreme variants, but like base ability wise, that was never going to happen ever.
Right. Yeah. No, I personally like it a lot just from, again, with that like lower budget standpoint of banging some bred horses together that were bred well in the previous algorithm that weren't good breeders. I know personally, all of my best like legendary and exclusive racers were just shit breeders, and now they're mediocre breeders. So I mean, that's cool. It's a step in the right direction, I definitely think.
Definitely agree on that. I know I went back and just looked at like what was our most successful like lineage, what was our most successful breed pre-algo, and I think we're like just shy of like 1 ETH profit with that horse, but like the amount that we spent on like trying to recreate it, because we're like, oh, this mother breeds really well, and then it's like you spend another like 0.15 breeding with another NAC Genesis, and then another 0.15 breeding with another NAC Genesis, and then you're like, oh, let's try Zavo, so that's whatever, 0.8. It's like I think we ended up spending a total of like 0.75 ETH trying to like just keep hitting the same mother with good horses and like not getting anything out of it.
Yeah.
So the idea that like as a new stable you can jump in and like take a hit at a like one more Tisha and know that maybe it will be like, you know, an elite horse. But at the end of the day, it's like you're not going to get like something that's garbage.
Right. Yeah, that was always something that held me back from going into the stud barn and kind of finding the best horse available pre-algo. Is just like, I don't want to spend that much money on something that might suck, you know? Which, yeah. And I say that knowing that like I'm breeding horses that also suck, but they're way cheaper, you know?
Right. I think we have like doubled how much we breed since the algo update. Like there's a reason for us to actually like breed for us, because we've seen some success. If you have one good horse, then suddenly like you breed it and now you have two good horses, and maybe that second one isn't quite as good as the first one, but that's a much better place to start than if you have, you know, 10 bad horses or 10 like decent horses pre-algo. You can breed them as much as you want. You just may never get anything out of it.
Right. So here comes Shadow the Hedgehog, break in with 200 meters to go. Not going to be enough for a podium, I don't think.
No, doesn't look like it.
Okay, so we've got, oh, and by the way, Dewey 1208 is the winner of Dear John. So Dewey, please put your wallet address in the chat and I will send you that horse, who also is obviously a marathoner. He's just doing his down class here, so you're gonna put this horse in a marathon. It's gonna be great. Fellas, we got an eighth place from Shadow the Hedgehog here, no flame, in a 1200. What are our thoughts and where are we headed next?
I think we will head straight to a 1000 next, see if we get a little bit stronger in the 1000 and the 1200. I don't hate the eighth place.
talk would have been nice. Why don't I personally? I mean, middle of the pack is just sort of blah, you know. Why don't?
Yeah, I think it's. Process? Yeah, I think it's far enough down that without looking at all of those other horses in the race, might not be the worst thing. Like we were hoping for something that obviously a sprinter, hopefully a little bit stronger than I think like what we're looking at, but just knowing that the mother of this horse, just knowing how she runs and sort of where she finishes is she does have a lot of those like 9th, 7th, 6th place finishes without flames. She'll win without flames. So I'm not super concerned.
So have you guys bred Hattie? Is Hattie Harrington, is that one of your horses, or did you go out of stable to get that one?
That was one of our horses. We bought the mother off Zook, I think. And then the dad was one that we picked up.
And so this is the first offspring that you've made. Is there a plan for more? What's your plan with Hattie?
Right. This one at the most basic level was Hattie has extremely strong sprint preference in BA, enough to be flame in C1 and one, the deathless, the mom side, it's variance, right? So you're trying to get a little bit more kick rather than just distance preference. And ultimately we probably didn't get the BA we want is what it looks like, because it should still flame, I think, in that field, hopefully maybe the 1000. So maybe not the best role, but we will definitely be breeding Hattie a decent amount, just because like we said, breeding 2.0, it's one of our best horses now. So we believe in racers, which kind of stinks for the Genesis. That's a whole nother topic, but I know Dan Shannon, BG, and it was all over the stream last night. I missed you, Chateau. I went to bed, I think, right before you came on, but
that's all right. Yeah, no, it was late. It was a late night for me as well. So
right, is people okay. People are going to stud barn and looking for racers now rather than who consistently. I mean, you still look at breeding talent because we know it's still a variable, but 1.0, we just had our horses that pumped out good offspring more frequently, went by that. Breeding 2.0, I mean, we're looking at strong racers that compete in 1 and 2 if we go out of stable. And in stable, you know, we're only breeding our best racers unless they have an urban cadet in the lineage or, you know, a stylish criminal, something like that.
Right. So do you two have your own stables as well, or are you just doing the joint venture?
All together for us.
Interesting.
Yeah, Eric, you want to talk about... Eric runs, I mean, other than probably Mango, I would say as many horses for Lucky Jack out of like our breeding barn. It's where all our donkeys go and all of Lucky Jack's horses that he can't. So I know Eric made the final four, second place, right? In the, which bracket was that? The March Madness bracket?
Yeah, that was March Madness.
So
our
that
was had a terribly unlucky run.
Rebranded to Chop Chop LJJC.
Nice. Yeah. We all know the name. Now we know the face. So as far as like breeding and like having actually like a stable of horses that you own, it's just Sample Gates, and then you guys jockey for LJ, and that's cool.
Yeah. Pretty much. Eric, my iPhone gives me suggestions of like when it says send message to, it's normally Eric because we just talk horses all day. I mean, who are we going to breed this week? Who's coming up? Who needs the blessing? What's the distance today? So it's like I said, it's been a great way to keep in touch.
Nice. So Eric, how did you get hooked up with LJ and doing the Jockey Club?
I think Brendan actually started in December. I know LJ was just like accepting people for the club, and then like I just love racing. Like I think it's so fun, and I mean that's mostly it. It's just I think I was like running out of I was sick. I caught COVID over like around Christmas. I'd taken a bunch of time off work, and like our stable, I was just running out of horses to run. And so that's sort of where I ended up getting started, was it's like, well, I don't have any horses to run. I'll just run these other ones.
I'm convinced so. Eric is like one of the best jockeys in the Zed metasphere, but we just don't have great horses. We do the most, the smallest amount, a pretty small budget. So it sounds really,
I mean, that's respectable.
It sounds cheesy, but like Zed is about the community. We love watching Pony Plug. So when LJ reached out, I was like, wow, this is a person you want to, you know, have in your camp, right? Or have a relationship with at the minimum. And Eric just took that to the next level. And we're planning to go to Saratoga. There's no details out for that yet, but I mean,
I think we're all planning to go to Saratoga. I don't really know what that means, but I want to be there.
Right? We tune into as many streams as we can. I'm looking at my follow channels on the left, and it's everybody, right? Whether it's a Twitter space or whatever, that there's a lot of people we respect and look up to. And it'd be great to meet those people in person. So I'm looking forward to it. I hope it works out.
Yeah, absolutely. So any last words before we let you fellas go and get Shadow the Hedgehog back on the track?
My message to everybody would be a little bit patient on 2.0. If it was easy, all the horses would be better than the Z1s and Z2s already, and it'd be throwing a fit. So maybe don't spend, you know, all your ETH. Buterins and Finnies seem to get their cost back.
You know, that's generally good advice anyway. Don't spend all your ETH.
Not financial advice. Though.
You know, save a little bit just in case. Just in case, like last week happens, you know? All right. Well, fellas, it's been a pleasure, and I appreciate you guys coming on, and best of luck on the track.
Yeah, definitely. Appreciate you having us on.
All right.
Thanks, fellas. Have a good rest of the evening. We'll stick around.
Likewise. All right. So we have the man, the myth, the turned off camera, Dan Chan, joining us. Connecting to audio. Oh, that's me. I'm not Dan Chan. Oh, man, what a reveal that would have been. You guys. Dan Chan, you there?
Hey,
there he is. Welcome in, bud. Thanks for joining us.
Sure, no problem. Glad to be here.
Yeah. So, you know, you need no introduction, but I don't know what horse you're racing tonight. So tell me a little bit about the horse we're going to be putting in a Griffin.
Well, it was a horse that I stole from Poseidon, and the reason I liked it was it had some really good bloodlines, you know, deep down. It's a knock exclusive three, and it's got some decent parents, and it's got some decent blood on the legendary side. So nice. I thought it would be interesting to give it a try.
What's its name?
Cherry Fire. Yeah, I haven't raced it yet, so.
Love it. So let's go ahead and take a look at the discovery page. So what was your breeding thought process here, as far as do you have both of the parents? Do you typically go at a stable for your sires or mares? What's your process here?
Do experiment a lot, right? Because usually I'm trying to work on a new feature, a new tool, a new thing. So I do a lot of more experimenting than most people, but for me the main thing is, you know, I try to stay in tunnel as much as I can. I always try to stay away from, you know, the real true mids, just because they don't have any distance preference, and you just need so much base ability and variance to be able to succeed there. So I always try to get, I don't like to go to the extreme poles, like to the 1026, because it's so competitive and there's so many strong bred horses in breeding 2.0 that it makes that, you know, really tough to get there. So I tend to try to stay on the fringes of the, you know, the 1420, 1222 stuff.
Nice. So with this particular horse, what are you expecting? What kind of a Griffin are we looking for?
I think we're going to look for something around the 2022 range.
Okay.
And I would hope that I could keep it.
So it looks like we got a 22 Buenos Aires Derby. It's empty, but the chat will, I believe in your chat. You can.
There's actually a 20 stuff. Right. There's actually a 20 right there that I think we can get, right?
It's only one spot left. So okay.
Let's try to grab that 22 then.
All right, Buenos Aires Derby, 2200 meter. Dan Shan is throwing in Cherry Fire. I'm gonna throw in, let's see, 22. I'm gonna throw Klop Sticks in here. So what are your thoughts, Dan Shan, on generally breeding 2.0 compared to 1.0? What have you found? What are you testing at this point?
You know, I still tend to think that it's really focused a lot on the idea of building pieces and blocks and putting things together to try to, I try to maintain the same level of whatever the, you know, the two features I have. And then I always try to increase the one weak feature. So if I have good base ability in my horse and I have good distance preference, I try to maintain that with the other parent. And then I try to increase, like, say, the variance, because mine may be low or something like that.
Right. So we heard PK talking on the charity stream last night about his thought that perfectly matching the DP gives you that power creep that John talked about. What are your thoughts about that?
Well, I think that matching DP is a good thing. I mean, you know, you're kind of eliminating one factor out of the equation. So that's always a positive. But I think more importantly is, I think that I look at DP as like an A-pitched roof. And I don't think that any horse truly has like a specific set DP. So to say that, you know, you're matching a 12 and a 12 would be like saying that you have a minus 80 and a minus 80, right, instead of a minus 84 and a minus 73. So I'm not against it. I just don't see it as clearly.
Right. You don't think there's like something in there where if you hit those lines, like if they line up perfectly, there's like some little boost there or something like that?
Yeah, I mean, maybe, yeah. Like, let's say, you know, like some kind of Easter egg theory kind of thing, you know, like something, right, where you get this magic recipe. I mean, yeah, sure. Why not? I mean, it's a video game, right?
Right. I forgot to do the giveaway. So type !Z in the Twitch chat if you want to try and win Klop Sticks. It's a Z22. What is she? Buterin Elite Filly. Should be. I've got Marathon Mid written on my piece of paper here, so we'll see how accurate that is. So Dan, what are your thoughts on grandparents and great-grandparents? What have you seen so far as breeding with sort of the historical DNA in mind?
You know, I'm really of the opposite. I haven't seen anything really significant to really point to anything more important than the parents. I think the parents are making up 95% of what we have. And I'm sure there are some examples out there, because when you breed 10,000 anything, you're going to see something. But I really think parents are the most important thing right now. I don't think, but I also have a theory that, okay, let's just imagine that a horse, you know, a baby gets a little something from everyone in the whole family line, right? Somehow, some way. So I always try to make sure that almost every one of those holes is closed with something decent. So in the theory that he could pull the worst trait from the worst parent, I want to make sure that worst parent is at least good, or grandparent or great grandparent.
Right. So have you gone back through your lineages of the horses just to make sure that there's no donkeys in there, or how does that sort of manifest into your strategy?
Yeah, you know, the thing is to try to avoid having that one bad horse in there that could leak into your baby.
Interesting. So what are your thoughts sort of generally? I know you've got your tournaments going on. You're doing a lot for the community to kind of try and vitalize things around here. What are your thoughts generally in the state of Zed?
Well, I think that, you know, I think that breeding 2.0 leaves a lot of holes for some of the poorer racing horses that we already have. And I'm not sure that maybe if I'm missing what the magic is going to be from them yet. But at this point, I really don't see the value of a glue Finney Genesis. Right. And that scares me, right? That scares me because that's 95% of our population.
Right. So what would you do to try and fix that a little better, turn the ship in the right direction?
Well, I think that breeding 1.0 was way too random. There was, you know, a lot of randomness there. I think breeding 2.0 is just very boring and very predictive. I think breeding 2.0 is for a data scientist. Breeding 1.0 is for a pure degen. I think that probably the perfect recipe is breeding 1.5, where we have some predictability, where we can predict some things, but at the same chance, we have the opportunity for a lower quality horse to be able to produce a high quality offspring.
Yeah, no, I agree for sure. So while we're waiting for this Griffin to fill, do you want to talk a little bit about your tournaments that you got going on?
Yeah, I mean, the tournaments are a great idea, right? I mean, in just the idea that there's 90% of the population that can't race, period. Right. They can't race free, they can't race paid, they can't race in tournaments. There's no place for them. So the tournaments with the special formats and some of the segmenting and the 3-5-7 tournaments, which are amazing and so much fun. I mean, they're just a blast. No one has ever complained. They are just a blast. Those are perfect for the horses that we're talking about, you know, that 90% of the population that's just parked. I don't even know what the numbers are, and I probably should look, but I'm lazy. But we really, I mean, it just seems like it's a breath of fresh air for so many of these stables that were parked or had limited use of a lot of their horses.
Yeah, no, for sure. Yeah, it's a great, and I know BG ran some numbers recently on the horses that have bred since the algorithm update, but I'm sure it'd be interesting to see as far as horses that sort of were absent from the track for a long period of time and have recently come back.
Yeah, I seen there was a chart that someone put up, and it showed that the average, since my tournament started, the average barn was running like 2 horses regularly. And since my tournament started, it's kind of seemed like it's climbed closer to 5 or 6.
That's awesome. Yeah. No, so all that stuff is great for the game while they sort of find their way from on the inside.
You know, the thing is that people always hear me complaining and crying, and I think they think that I'm crying a lot about the game. And most of the time I'm crying about the waiting room, right? Because I consider what we're doing right now the waiting room. I don't consider what we have now the game. Right. Most of my tears and complaints come from, hey, give me something to do while I'm waiting to see the doctor.
Need better magazines.
Exactly. That's exactly what I want.
Yeah. No, I mean, and the Dan Chan tournaments and the Pony Plug and Zombie and all those tournaments, those are the magazines that we need to peruse while we wait for things to come about.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, like with the 3-5-7 tournaments, if you had a friend and you wanted to introduce them to the game, they could literally go on, you know, Haku, buy a horse, a $20, $40, $50 horse, and it could literally be competitive in the 3-5-7 or the 4-2-6 tourneys now.
Yeah. Where, yeah, no, I know I've got a whole stable full of horses that would probably, if I took the time to go and dig through the horseshoe charts, I'm sure I've got the dozens of them. I'm sure we all do.
I honestly, in my conversations with a lot of the seniors ed staff, I think that 3-5-7 is a great onboarding experience. I think it could be a huge key to onboarding, right? Like, it's a great way to get into the game, not put a lot at risk, learn it, and not be up against these monster horses the second you walk in the door.
Yeah, no, it's great on both ends, because they're, if you're competing in the 3-5-7, you're trying to aim for different spots, so winning's not the only goal. And then also the overall ecosystem, if there's people competing for 3-5-7s, then sort of makes the whole field a little bit easier, makes things a little bit lighter on the little guys.
And plus the entry is a lot cheaper, right? The onboarding is a lot cheaper. You don't need to spend $5,000 to be competitive. You could be competitive for, you know, a donkey price of, you know, $40-$50 or something.
Right. Yeah, and I see Aquila Creek Stables in the chat saying his racing has doubled, if not tripled, with your tourneys, and no desire to race in dailies, which is I agree totally, like with my caliber of horse that I breed. I can qualify for dailies all day, but then it's just like, why even try? Because I'm not going to flame or do anything in the quarterfinal or semifinal. So, you know, I've kind of given up on that. I'm sure a lot of people are in the same boat.
Yeah, and that's what scares me the most, right? Is like, I mean, I know everyone thinks that there's a 2 billion people that want to play this game because it's so much fun for the people that do enjoy it and are into it. But losing people is never good for business, you know? Losing interested people is never good. And if we have people that are interested now, I prefer to give them some toys and some good magazines to play with while we figure out exactly how this thing is really supposed to work.
Yeah, for sure. I agree. All right, so let's do this giveaway real quick before we jump into Flames. Taiga? T-I-E-G-A-H. Taiga, you've won the Clopsticks. So put your wallet address in the Twitch chat, and I will send that over to you as soon as we're done here tonight. All right, Dan, you've got Flames. As a Z3, I mean, sort of expected in this field. What are we expecting? Are you hoping to win by a couple of seconds here, seeing that there's not really anything close to your genotype in this race?
Well, I think I think that you're going to find that most of these higher end horses that are in these races, these people are breeding them. Most of these are probably breeding them for a reason. So I would assume a lot of these Z12, Z15 Finneys and Buttes probably have a ton of variance. So I would expect that one or two of those is probably going to show a ton of variance and probably leave me on a podium somewhere.
Interesting. So talking about your stable and your breeding, since the algorithm, we're 2-3 cycles in now. What's been your best horse that you've bred post algorithm?
A lot of elites. Yeah, you know, like Fire Unrest is a great horse I just bred, and it's an elite Nakamoto, and it's a great horse. I mean, it's flaming and free class ones. It's tourney flaming. It's qualifying. It's a great horse. Wow.
What was the thought process behind that breed?
It was the same process that we just kind of talked about. You know, it was more of just, you know, like kind of matching things together and then trying to build a little bit on the, you know, on the parts that we felt that the horse was, you know, kind of lacking. Like Sweet Fire comes from a great bloodline, the mom. And the thing about Immutable Unrest was Immutable Unrest is a great horse, but has a ton of variance. Well, Sweet Fire lacked the variance, and Fire Unrest picked up a lot of her variance, got the base ability from the lower Z parent, you know, grandparents and parents. And it's a great horse. I mean, Fire Unrest is a great horse.
Interesting. And I see Catch Me Riding Derby has the Stallion. So what do you, when you look for a breeding pair, do you just use the blood tool and just sort of get whatever horse looks like the best pair? Or did you have a relationship with Catch Me Riding Derby previous and like have sort of a breeding deal?
Well, they're blood tool guys, so I, you know, we do a lot of sharing and cuddling all in the blood tool. But the thing was is that we have a tool that actually basically lets us kind of like sort and filter through the different horses in stud, and you can see, you know, try to find what you're looking for specifically. But that horse was a great horse. I mean, I would breed with that horse 100 times.
And is that just based on the variance that it has, or what are the, without having like, obviously I'm not a blood tool member, I'm a Buterin man, what can you look at just on like a horseshoe or a hockey page and see like what stands out about this horse?
Well, the thing is that this horse has already got like a really, you know, decent breeding, you know, ability. It's got a couple horses that did pretty well. It flames consistently in class one in some close to the middle distances, which implies it's got some decent base ability. It also tends to flame and finish, you know, at the bottom of the pack, which is like 10, 11, 12 for a low Z legendary. That would imply that it has a lot of variance as well. Hmm. So you could get those things without having any blood tool, you know?
Right. Yeah, no, that's exactly the information I was hoping you would let leak. That's great. All right, so we are running 2200 meter Griffin. We've got, we actually got enough time to talk about horses here. We got Certain Adrenaline, gate one, Ajak, Clopsticks, and yeah, Taiga, this is your horse now, Clopsticks, wish them luck. Homemade Dynamite, Redacted Fish, Lunar Goddess, T-Som, Kunu, Mountain Glue, Pure Zero, Cherry Fire, and Missionary Accomplished from High Horse, also with a flame down there in gate 12.
Missionary Accomplished, that's a great name.
Oh man. So where, speaking of names, you've got your fire sort of legacy built there. What was that was pre Flames in the game, wasn't it, that you started naming horses Fire?
Yeah, my first horse, one of my very first horses that I bred was named Firestrike.
Where did that come from? Was that just a cool name you liked?
The horse was Atomic Tangerine, so I wanted like some kind of atomic fire, strike, kind of like, like some atomic bomb thing, kind of something. So I kind of just snuck out with, Firestrike, and then it just seemed like from that day on, I just stuck with fire forever and kind of branded it now, right? Like if you see a fire horse, you kind of think of Dan Shen.
Yep, it is definitely branded well. So we got Cherry Fire way out in front. And
don't look like she's gonna hold though, right?
I don't know. I don't know if anybody's really coming. Still 350 meters to go.
Oh, she's got a big lead. She's fine.
There's somebody coming from the back. Is that T-Som? T-Som's coming. Might be close, but I think she's got enough.
Well, that's gonna get real close. That one's coming hard.
Yeah,
she's got it. Yep,
good. So we got a win with a flame at a 2200 meter. I should have looked to see. I don't even know what the maiden finals distances are, but what's your next step with this horse after a flame and a win in 22? Where are we headed?
Well, 22 kind of was a yucky number, right? Because I got stuck in the marathon funnel, which I really don't want to be in. So I'll probably just go to the 18-20 range and finish out the run and try to qualify.
Nice. All right. So you've got a Twitter Spaces coming up this week with Chris Ebeling, and I believe maybe Jay or ZG is going to be there.
Whoever's feeling tough enough to fight with me, yeah, they'll be there.
Nice. So tell me about that. When, where, what? How do we listen?
It's Tuesday at 3 p.m. New York time, and it's early in the day. Usually I do my Twitter Spaces Tuesday night, but I'm doing it early because Ebs is from the UK, so it kind of catches him before he goes 99. So we're doing it Tuesday at 3 p.m. New York time, and it's going to be Ebs, it's going to be ZG, and if you could read my direct messages between me and Ebs, you would know what you're expecting is going to be World War VII. So people got to tune into this. I mean, I know I market and sell everything constantly. I'm telling you, this is must hear Twitter Spaces.
Yeah, no, I mean, I can only imagine, because Ebs is always very forthcoming with whatever information he has, and you're obviously not going to pull any punches, so that should be a good conversation.
Yeah, and we went back and forth with some questions, and it feels like it's really going to be I really feel like we're going to get a lot more meat than we've ever gotten.
Nice. That's awesome. Well, we're looking forward to it. Awesome. Thanks, Dan Shen. Appreciate you joining us tonight. And,
sure, man, it was great. And anytime you want me back, just let me know.
Yeah, I mean, we don't do these very often, every 2 weeks. And actually, next maiden falls on Memorial Day here in the States, so I don't know if I'm going to be doing that one. But yeah, I'd love to have you back on some kind of stream sometime soon. And I wish you luck with Cherry Fire here in the maiden tournament.
Thanks, man. Talk to you soon.
Awesome. Thanks, man.
All right. Bye bye.
All right. So there goes Dan Shen. Remove. Don't report. Zoom, why you always got to make me report people? I don't want to report him. I just want to move on. Okay, so just a reminder, we've got the Breed for Speed NASCAR Zed Pass tournament. So if you're a Zed Pass holder, your freshly raced horses qualify for this Breed for Speed tournament. So, that's neat. All right, so now we've got Bellamy Stables joining us. Welcome. How are you doing tonight?
I'm good. How are you doing?
I am, we are on schedule, so I'm doing great. Doing great.
Yeah.
So, tell us about yourself. I feel like you're fairly new to the Zed scene. How'd you find the game? Tell us about your stable and what you got going on.
Okay. Well, I have been in crypto for, I want to say, almost 3 years now, and then started getting into NFTs about a year and a half ago. So I don't even remember how I really found Zed. I just kind of think I found it on Twitter, people talking about it, and I was like, that's awesome. Cause I grew up, with my grandfather had like a real horse racing stable when I was a kid. So like horses have been my thing. So I was like, this is That's perfect awesome. For me. Nice. Yeah, I just got really into it. So yeah, I got into it around December, and then I think January I got very serious about it, but I've only gotten horses that can like do anything recently. So
how many horses do you have at this time?
In my main stable, I think I have about 16 or 17 right now. I do have like my blue horses chilling somewhere else than breeding stable and stuff like that. So I would say like combined like 25, 30 at the moment.
Nice. So tonight we're going to be, I know how that works. Tonight we're going to be racing Magic Mac. So yep. Tell me a little bit about this horse and your breeding. I see that the sire is outside of your stable. So what was your thought process on this breed?
So this is kind of an experiment for me. I raced in the Lucky Maiden, and I was really inspired by Doomed by Helen because I've seen a lot about that horse on Twitter recently, just with like the new algo change and how that horse is able to compete in C1, paid I think around like the 250 mark for the most part, but has almost been like a sign of hope for people that you can breed a horse that can compete in C1. So I kind of made this horse trying to follow the breeding data that I used from the Zedge tool to kind of replicate that horse. So we'll see if it worked, but
no, so is your strategy to match DP, build on base ability? What's your strategy as far as pairing up your breeds?
So for me, I've been looking a lot at pairing up distance preference because I've had success with two other horses doing that. But I also, my best horses are actually variance horses. So I get really interested in trying to breed variants into it. I'm not like, anytime I do and anytime they have higher variance, they just perform better. So I'm sure I can expand on that eventually, but that's like my goal right now. So nice. This specific horse was bred with a more than average variance mother and a more than average variance father, trying to kind of replicate that. And then they both had sprinter, DP, and then the dad's has a good base ability, but the mom's base ability is horrible. So we'll see if he gets it from the dad.
Nice. Okay, so let's jump into the discovery page here and see what's your ideal distance for a Griffin race with Magic Mac?
I was thinking 1,000 or 1,200.
Okay, so we got a 1,200 with 4 of 12, or there's also 1,000. Your choice.
Let me reload the page. I'm losing the 12. All right. Let's go for the 1,000.
Sounds great. I'm going to be throwing Struggle Bus into this race. A Z42 Buterin Elite Filly. So it's that time again, chat. Type exclamation point Zed. Just a second here. There we go. All right. Yeah, and are you working on a stable logo? Because, I mean, I don't want to draw too much attention to this thing here, but... I mean, it's lovely. It's lovely, but
oh yeah,
I heard you're working on a stable logo.
I am, yeah. I'll eventually have one, but that was a nice placeholder from Blossom Racing for the moment. So
nice. So what? How have you been breeding much since the? I know you're kind of a smaller stable, so I don't know how much you've been, how many horses you've bred since the update, pre-update. But what are your thoughts just on sort of breeding in general?
So I didn't really breed much post-algo. I tried once and it was a complete failure, so I was very discouraged.
This time I've bred a couple. I've had some moderate success. They're not monsters or anything, but they did really well in the Lucky Maiden, and I have one that is a high Z mute that can perform in like C3 and win paid in there, so I'm pretty happy with that. Also has an easy down button.
Nice. And was that sort of a predictable breed? Is there anything you can kind of learn from that?
Yeah, so I bred that one using
my high BP sprinter.
That's usually like the 70-80 range on Zedge. So
I kind of expected them to be like a 1,000, 1,200 specialist, and they end up being so, and they down pretty easy in the marathon. So that's predictable.
Nice. That's awesome. So you said you only bred one time and got discouraged.
Yeah.
You know, You're not enough of a gambler apparently for the pre-algo update breeding, because yeah, that's I bred hundreds of times and it never worked. But you got to just keep trying. No, I shouldn't say never. I got a bunch of good ones. So I'm gonna jump over here in my second stable and throw negative returns into this Griffin as well, just to help us get this thing filled. But chat, if you have a 1,000 meter Griffin, you want to throw in here, that'd be lovely. So tell me a little bit about the mare here, your horse Drifter Princess. Is this a horse that you bought, bred? What's the story here?
I actually bought her after I watched the sire perform in a race. He's not like Ready, Set, Boom or anything like that, but it was a sprint and he did one of those like 200, 100 meter, like quick, just came out of nowhere and finished. And I was like, okay, I love this horse. So I found her for sale actually. And I bought her, she's not bad, especially in C2, I get flames and freeze, and she qualified today for the tourney, so I'm happy with her. But
there you go.
Her lineage is so interesting because she has like 6 breeding pairs in her lineage, but each time, like the mom has been bred with a genesis. So she's getting all that base ability, which I thought would be interesting to see.
But her lineage, gotta be something to that.
Right. And like the lineage traces all the way back to Jordan, the Z2 Knock. So I was like, maybe I'll get something from that. We'll see.
Yeah. No, I mean, I'm still just clicking. There it is, Jordan. Yeah, yep. So that goes back 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 levels. Yeah, that's super interesting that potentially now that kind of stuff matters, whereas before it was just a luck of the draw.
Right. And so I just kind of carried that on and bred her again with a Genesis Finny, just to kind of keep it going and see if it actually, like, over time made it more powerful or what the deal is there. So this is just gonna be like a fun thing to see what happens.
Nice. So was that Britannicus, this Genesis Finny that you found, was that like just through Zedgetool or what was your process?
Yeah.
Yeah, nice.
And then I also looked and saw that like on the VSim tool that he may be able, like he doesn't have a lot of data. Whoever owns him doesn't race him very often, hasn't raced him much since January. But it says that it has a high enough sample to determine he could compete in C1 paid. So it's like, maybe that'll carry over. So this horse can at least make it to C1 and do something. And if not, best case scenario, it's a decent turning horse.
Yeah. I mean, it's got some pretty solid odds data from back when odds were a thing.
Yeah. So I was really interested in that.
Huh. Yeah, that is interesting. It's got, I mean, sub 10 odds in $10 paid races is nothing to scoff about.
Right. So I was hoping, you know, that they'll get most of the genes from the dad, but kind of the variance and the strong distance preference. But I just noticed that the dad can also compete in mids as well. And I was like, oh no, like,
this might not be the sprinter I want it to be, but hopefully it'll be an okay horse.
Yeah. I mean, we can only hope. And speaking of hopefully it'll be an okay horse, the giveaway for Struggle Bus has ended. Let's pick a winner. Slim Reefa, you are the winner. And Monster Runs in the chat there. We got one more horse to give away with our next guest. So you got another chance in about 15 minutes or so. All right, so Slim Reefa, if you are in the chat, please paste your wallet address. And I will send you Struggle Bus after this is over. All right. Let's see here. We need one more horse in this 1,000 meter Griffin. Por favor.
Oh, it looks like we got it.
Did it fill? Beautiful.
Yeah.
All right. So let's check out flames. We got no flames anywhere. Neither of my horses got a flame. And Magic Mac did not get a flame either, with a Z17, Z19, Z11. So some lighter competition, no flame. What do you make of this early sort of, it's not the best news, obviously, but what are you taking out of this?
So with it being a lighter field, that concerns me definitely. But I was kind of aiming for some variance in there, so I'm hoping that
maybe that's just the reason why I did it with lanes. I guess we'll see based on
where they end up placing. So.
Yeah, I mean, and since you're breeding for variance, that's obviously gives you some hope. Yeah, and so struggle busted Slim Reefa. Oh, Slim Reefa is here. Cool. Paste your wallet address in the chat, please, and I will send you Struggle Bus, who is Steed of Sound and Burn the Fleet, a couple of sprinters. So, as far as exclusive, what is this exclusive elite? Elite Buterins go, this horse is bred well, damn it. So it may not compete in this field, but someday when Z40 plus elite Buterin fillies that are orangish have their own segmented racing, this horse is going to dominate. So what you say you've been in Zed for, what is it, May? So 5-6 months now. What's your general take on this roller coaster ride that we're all on here?
I know there is a lot of drama going on with Zed right now.
I try to stay out of it because like
I have faith that the team will eventually do its best. I mean, nothing we do is really going to change it, I don't feel like. So I just kind of let them do their thing. I've been involved with a lot of crypto and NFT projects, and it's always rough in the beginning, especially because Zed's still in beta.
Yeah, I definitely have hope for the future.
I understand there's some growing pains there, so I'm hoping that's all it is.
Yeah, no, definitely. They've come a long way. I've been around for a year and something now, and yeah, it's definitely come a long way. There's speed bumps, as one's come to expect, but
we're right. I definitely think the premise.
Yeah, like the premise behind it can definitely be successful in the long term.
It's just a matter of getting that all together and figuring out all the kinks.
Yeah, absolutely. Like the thought of just the digital ownership of horses and being like, it's, yeah, the idea is there and the execution is there. And especially from like a streaming standpoint, the game is there on a visual level. I know there's a lot of competitors coming out, which are great. I play a lot of them, but they don't look very good, you know?
Right.
So like as many problems as Zed has, that mass adoption, I think some of these games are going to have some trouble when they try and sell to the general public, and they don't particularly look all that great, which I mean can be overrated, but you know, I think when we're talking mass adoption, I think that matters.
Oh yeah, I agree. And that's like a big reason like I've kind of just like stuck with Zed, is that I just see more potential in it in the way it's designed. It's been working out stuff way longer than these other projects coming out, so I would feel like they're steps ahead, even though it doesn't always feel that way to the community.
Yeah, no, the community is and I see somebody's choosing violence in the chat, and you know, just mute. Twitter has a very, very well functioning mute button, and it'll make your life much better. All right, so we've got Magic Mac Z32 Butte in gate 1. I've got Negative Returns in gate 7 and Struggle Bus in gate 9, which Struggle Bus is going to Slim Reefa after the stream is over here. So best of luck to you and your new horse, Slim Reefa. So what are we hoping to see here? No flames, but it is hopefully the right distance funnel. So what's your ideal? Are you looking for a 12th because of the variance, or what are you hoping for here?
Yeah, I mean,
if it's high variance, it's either gonna get a 12th or a first. Like that's usually how my variance horses go. My one horse is in the 90s level of variance, and it's always like first or 12th, like there's no in between, right. So I would like to see that variance in there. If not, I'm just crossing my fingers for a podium somehow, some way.
Yep, so what we can only hope for. Get that good Griffin payout before you get it to Discovery and you're playing for pennies.
Oh yeah.
All right, so here we go. 500 meters to go. Judgment Knight has broken. Magic Mac holding back. Negative Returns is making a run at things. Here comes Magic Mac with an okay break, but I don't know if it's going to be enough. It's not going to be enough. What do we got here? Judgment Knight. Cheats on Sheets comes in first. Struggle Bus with the 11th. All right, so we got Magic Mac and a 10th. Obviously it's not ideal, but what are we taking from here? What are your thoughts seeing that Magic Mac finished 10th in the 1,000 meter?
Personally, like, Discovery, sometimes I have horses that do absolutely, like, horrible in Discovery, and then they get out into the real field and they do, like, so much better. They get flames. So I guess I'm just going to try, like, maybe throw him in a couple of mids, see if he's more of a mid-distance, which hopefully not, because I put him in the distance-specific zombie racing tournament. but, you know, maybe, like, keep trying with that and just see if it's, like, a variance thing or if he's really just a donkey.
Yeah, so what's your next step, 1,000-meter Griffin? What are you going to, which funnel, what distance, what's your next Discovery race with this horse?
I think I want to try a 1200 just because the dad had like 4.9 odds there. So I just want to see if maybe that rubbed off.
Nice. Awesome. All right. Well, anything else you want to divulge while you're on stream here? I know you've been kind of hinting at starting streaming yourself. Is there a Twitch? Can we follow you? What's going on?
Well, I am planning to start something soon once I get past all the nerves, and this was a great starting point. But yeah, you can follow me on Twitter, and I'll of course update there if I throw something up and I get something together, which I'm planning it, but I just don't know when yet.
Cool. Sounds great. Well, I appreciate you coming on, and best of luck with Magic Mac and the 1200 meter coming up.
Thank you. Thanks so much for having me on.
Yeah, absolutely. Anytime. All right. So, moving along, we have... Oh yeah, I was going to talk about merch. Did you guys see this? Zed's got merch. I don't know. I felt like this was something we could talk about. So they got these hoodies with a little horse on the back. Shirt with a little horse on the back. Beanie. Hat. How about that? Huh? It's not available yet. I'm not sure when it's available. At some point, you can sign up for try and win some free stuff. If you go to your stable on Zed, click on your stable, and there's this little shopping basket visit merch store thing up here. So yeah, check that out. It's gonna be great. And Zed's doing some giveaways too. Like last night on Avon's stream, they gave away like 20 or 30 packs of merch. So you better believe your ass I'm going to be trying to get some of that free merch to give away on these maiden streams. So stay tuned. Maybe next time we'll get you guys some merch. Okay, so without further ado, we've got our final guest of the night coming up in the background here. We got DK Racing. Welcome in, sir.
Hey, Chateau, how are you?
Man, I'm doing so good. We are right on schedule. Everything's going great. I'm down 5 horses so far, but that's okay.
Let's make it 6. Sounds good.
Let's make it 6. So tell me a little bit about Matt. Interesting coincidence that Bellamy just raced Magic Mac, and now you're bringing Fat Mac to the table. So tell me a little bit about Fat Mac.
Yes, this is a horse that's he's cultivating mass right now. Most of my stable is Glue, Buterins, and Finney's. I rolled out a good one for you though. I've got one Zabo Genesis mare. So she's the mom of Fat Mac. And then this is one I've been kind of my breeding strategy lately has been doing fewer breeds, but going more premium. So this is one I ponied up, found a Z2 Genesis in the stud finder here. And, he's got pretty high variance as well. So I'm hoping to maybe tap into some of that. So that's the hope. I'm hoping this is a good one.
Nice. So let's find a griffin, and then we can talk a little bit more about your thought process. So what distance, what funnel are we looking for here?
Oh, either a 12 or a 14. If we can get one, 1,000 would be fine too, though. It's
like there's a 14, but there's only one spot left. So
yeah, you want to do the 1,000?
Yeah, sounds great. Yeah. The Sweden Oaks, let's jump in the 5 of 12.
Yeah, that sounds good.
Okay. A little bit quicker. What's your gate?
I'll take 12.
Okay, awesome. So I'm going to throw a horse named Man Cub into this race. It's a Z32 Buterin Cross. And you jumped the gun, Zed Stabler. We're not ready yet. Hang on, I gotta click the button. Man Cub, there we go. Exclamation point Zed in the chat if you wanna win Man Cub. I will send that over this evening. Okay, so you said you chose About a Girl from the Stud Barn. Was that just like scrolling through? What's your tool of choice when you're looking for a stud?
Yeah. So I joined up Blood Tool a few months back. So I run a joint stable with some buddies as well. A knock gen mare, and so we made an investment there in Blood Tool. So that's usually kind of my process. It just saves a lot of time to be able to search through studs and just look for exactly the traits I'm looking for. So this one kind of playing with the idea that maybe variance passes a little bit easier from dads. I have no data that proves that, but I kind of have been trying to find some higher variance dads. Always want to match distance preference, and then this one here was trying to find like the highest variance knock genesis I could, and this one hit that.
Nice. And a quick aside, Fat Finger Gaming TV in the chat, challenge accepted. We'll work on that. A themed maiden, it's coming. So when you find a horse like this, About a Girl, is this a horse that you've bred with in the past, or when you find a horse like out of stable to breed with, do you like, you have like a list going of all your best studs that you like, or how is it sort of a case by case basis?
Yeah, I don't really. I probably should. I mean, if it's like a stable or someone that I know well, like I've got a couple horses that we've done breed deals and gone back to a few times. This one, and honestly, I've been doing more of this lately, you know, because it like I want to search through the entire like population of studs that I can find, right? So I've been doing more just like random breeds. I don't even know who the stable owner is of About a Girl here. So I'm trying to be sure that we're making the most of every breed, and it's a good match with the mare. So this was one just breeding with a rando stable here. We'll see how it goes.
Nice. So I know you have some good bred horses in your arsenal. What have you found as far as pre and post algo breeding some of those good racers?
Yeah, it's a great point. So it's funny, like I had a couple horses that I felt like were good breeders but not good racers in 1.0. And now those good breeders are shitty breeders, and now my better horses like Kelly Clarkson has actually made a few decent horses already herself. She was a terrible breeder in 1.0, so it's definitely like it feels to me like it's just more direct, like whatever trait that horse has, those traits are passing down.
Interesting. Yeah. So have you had an opportunity to take that to the second level? Like, have you bred any of Kelly Clarkson's offspring yet?
Yeah, I've started to. So actually, so the one that I threw in earlier when you were with High Horse is one of those. So that was breeding one of Kelly Clarkson's offspring with
so
another.
That's working.
She actually pulled off two wins. I ran her in 5 discoveries here. Wow. Since that one, so she's looking pretty good. But
what's the name of that horse? I'll pull it up.
That was Buff Biscuit.
That's right. Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting. So is that
you know, and we'll see, because like The other thing that I'm finding is like it's become very easy to like get predictable distance preference. So like this one is like, it's the maiden. I'm gonna just run 5 marathons. I know it's a good horse, or I know it's gonna be decent there. So it's easy to sort of think that you have a good horse early on in discovery because you know exactly where to put it. And then I'm finding that most of my breeds are hitting a wall really quick once they get out of discovery. So we'll see. I you know, it doesn't necessarily mean too much yet.
Yeah. Yeah. So strategy here, considering it's the maiden tournament day, you're just going to park this horse and see if it qualifies? Or what's your thought process with Buff Biscuit?
Yeah, I'll keep an eye on the cut line. Depending on how busy my day is tomorrow, I'll keep an eye on the cut line and you know throw her in another one if I need to qualify. But probably park her here, park him here, and then honestly, I'll probably run 5 sprints and try to get him down in class for post discovery after that.
Yep, that's the old tried and true tank.
Yep. Exactly.
Excuse me, I got a little frog in my throat here. So 1,000 meters, what are we hoping to see here?
Yeah, so I we definitely want to flame here. This is a horse that's, you know, pretty high. I'm hoping is going to be pretty high base ability. And then, you know, it's a D6 and I got to refresh here, but looking at this field, it looks like I've got one of the lower Z's in the field. So we definitely want to see a flame. Unless there's some real strong sprinters in the field, then maybe would see, but I definitely want to see a flame in this. I'd like to see a win.
Yeah, for sure. Whew, sorry. All right, here we go. Flames are out. Uh-oh, bad news.
Ooh.
Bad news.
Uh-oh. Okay.
Fat
All
Mac
right.
has lost his flame. So what's your immediate reaction here? What are you thinking?
I'm hoping, I'm looking at the stable. I don't know too many of the, I know Great Tempest, but I don't know the other two flaming stables here, but.
Yeah, so we've got a Z13 Finny Cross that looks like it's probably got grandeur in its lineage somewhere.
Yeah.
Magnificent grandeur. Yeah, a couple of pretty good parents looking like here.
And my hope would be these three are just amazing sprinters, right? And I'm just not in my best distance here in a 1,000.
Yeah. Oh, Jesus Christ. 42%. Yeah. It looks like these are bred pretty well. Oh gosh, hang on. Talk for a second. I gotta cough this thing up.
Yeah. No. You're good. You're good. Yeah. Absolutely. You know, I know you were showing the merch there, and I'm curious how many people are going to be, you know, going for the $80 hoodies. I might, because I'm a sucker for anything Zed. I'll spend, I just spent way more than that breeding probably glue Buterins. So
right.
So we'll see. But I don't know what's your play on the merch.
I'm giving away well over $80 worth of horses tonight. Yeah. So, I know I think. Everything's expensive right now, and like NFT merch in general, like I don't know if you know if you've noticed like the doodles and the Bored Apes and like all the NFT projects that are releasing merch. If you go and look, like it's just insane how much they're charging. Like I think the Bored Ape hoodies were 160, so
yeah,
like
yeah.
I see $80 for a hoodie, I'm like, oh shit, that's a discount.
Yeah.
So like I don't know, I everything's crazy expensive right now, so we can only hope that the quality is solid. I mean, that's
yes.
I mean, an $80, if it's a legit like good hoodie, $80 is not insane.
Yeah, but
we'll see. If it shows up and it's like thin and shitty, then
yeah, we'll see. Yeah, exactly. I'm with you. I'll be getting one. There's just no way around that.
Yeah. No, I know. And that's the thing. Like we're all bitching, but we're all going to be wearing that shit as soon as it comes. So
yes.
That's Zed in a nutshell. We all complain, but then we all see each other on the track every day. So.
Yep. We can't stop. That's it. We're pot committed here. We're all in.
They got us. So, let's talk a little bit more just general breeding thoughts and like state of Zed. I know you've been around. You've been around for quite a while. How long have you been in the game?
I've been in for it's about a year. I think it was end of May last year. I bought my first horse, so yeah, it's been about a year. So
you've had an opportunity to see quite a bit, a few different phases of the game. So what are your thoughts currently as far as like how the current state of Zed and where we're headed?
Yeah. I mean, I think just in general, we can talk about breeding too, but I think just like generally, I don't know. I mean, I always have looked at Zed as just such a long time horizon investments for me that I don't know. I mean, I don't get too worried about like the day-to-day issues or like not like, I mean, Zed to me, almost all Zed problems boil down to communications, right? So like if we hadn't been communicated certain things, like I think we would be very happy with where we stand right now, you know, if you'd shown us Zed today versus a year ago when I started. So, I don't know, like there's a lot that you know could be better for sure, but I'm not too concerned with that. I think there's going to be a lot more changes coming down the road. I'm personally very excited for like the rental platform and all that coming. I'm sure you are too with your
absolutely
thousand yeah. horses you have.
Yeah, probably. No, and I've been renting out my Riot Racers drivers. I've got nice. A Riot Racers garage with a couple of friends. And
yeah,
the market crashed, obviously, like Riot token is like basically worthless at this point, but
yeah,
but we've got like 8,000 Riot token after like a week or two of renting out our drivers, like, and we don't even have that big of a garage. So yeah, the potential of rental, if the tokenomics or whatever is just sustainable, which I am absolutely not smart enough to talk about or even know how that works, but like
right.
You just see all these PDE games where the token comes out and immediately crashes. So that worries me a little bit.
But agreed.
Anyway,
agreed.
So yeah, like it's, you know, take your time, guys. Don't fuck it up.
Yep. I'm with you.
All right. So Fat Mac down here in gate 12, cult invading mass. He's fallen all the way to the 12th gate. And we've got 500 meters to go. Who's going to sprint first? There he goes.
Off.
He is running and
he's running like he's a little heavy.
Yeah, he's running a little, he's got a little mass to him for sure.
Nobody's making a move here though.
Yeah, this is a slow, you might have a podium because nobody else wants it.
Sneak it out, he snuck in there.
Yeah. All right, so third place from Fat Mac on a kind of an anticlimactic race. What do we take from that? No flame. Look, you've got the fourth place flame right behind you, so you're sandwiched in with the flames. What do we learn from that?
Yeah, that's interesting because I mean it's the flaming horses there were first, second, fourth, and I was third. So it makes me feel like maybe this was kind of a chalk race, and maybe Mac is at least on the edge there. So I don't know. So it makes me. I like that a lot better than sixth or seventh. I'd be not feeling good about him right now if that were the case. But I'm gonna be curious. I'm definitely gonna hit a 1200 or 1400 here soon. I have a feeling that's gonna be more his sweet spot. So so yeah, we'll see. I don't hate that.
Nice. And then real quick, I picked the winner for the chat. BB12 Ego. You won Man Cub, so drop your wallet address in the Twitch chat and we'll get that sent over to you. Okay, so you said you're headed to 12 or 14 with Fat Mac. What if he continues to not flame in the short funnel? At what point do you try a different funnel?
Good question. So I don't know how what you found, but I have found almost a 0% rate of horses that fall outside of the funnel of their parents, right? So like, so this, he was bred from a 1200 preference and a 1400 preference horse. So if he doesn't flame the 12 and the 14, like this thing's going to the glue barn, you know, pretty much right away. So I don't know. I mean, maybe I'll play around a little bit. Maybe I'll try an 18. Maybe I'll try something on the other end. But I feel like in breeding 2.0, I'm almost 100% confident of what funnel it's going to be if I've bred matching, you know, distance preference horses.
Yeah. Yeah. And if you've bred enough since the new algorithm to feel pretty confident with that.
Yeah, way too much. So I'm definitely like I mentioned before, like when breeding 2.0 first came out, I bred everything. I was like, I'm gonna figure this out, you know, and I bred all my donkeys, and then I've since like stopped. Like my threshold for a mare that I'm gonna breed is much higher now, but yeah, I feel like I've been doing enough to kind of figure out that definitely distance preference matching is a thing, and then, you know, from there it's hard to tell. But
so what percentage would you say you're breeding in stable versus out of stable?
Good question. So in 1.0, I bred almost everything either in stable or with breed deals, because I felt like it really didn't matter. Like it was just try to get too high BA and then just right. Some ram's gonna pop out. So but lately I've been doing a lot more out of stable. So like Fat Mac, like it was, hey, I've got this Zabogenesis mare, she's a sprinter, she's pretty high base ability, I want to try to add some variance into the mix and also match the sprint preference. And so I went out of stable to try to find the right match for her, whereas before, like I might've just matched her with a, you know, I've got a Z5 Genesis male. I might've just matched her with that, or I might've found a buddy and got a discount or something. So it's a lot more out of stable now.
Interesting. Yeah. I probably need to like take heed of that, 'cause I'm still just mashing my, I mean, I have some decent stuff to mash together, so it'll take me a few months to try that all out, but
yeah,
at some point I'm going to need to reach out and get some better blood in my stable.
Well, breeding 1.0 was just it was an ROI game, right? It was like, hey, this is a lotto ticket whether I go out of stable or in stable, so I might as well breed for half the price to get the same like bloodline, right? Or yeah. Same,
right?
But now there actually is some strategy to it, which I think that I would like some element of the lotto back, but you know, it's now you really do want to try to find the right, you know, horses to put together.
Yeah. So have you, and forgive me if I already asked this, but have you been looking to the grandparents and great grandparents to make sure that that DP lines up as well, or are you just doing the parents?
Mostly just the parents. Maybe I need to get out of this, but I'm still trying to breed with a lot of Genesis where I can, Genesis males. So maybe that's 1.0 thinking.
Which I mean, but it could just be that you're building your bloodlines. So it's like you're starting from that top to make sure that you have that aligned all the way down, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Yep. So that's the other thing too. I think Dan Chan mentioned it, like building blocks. Like that's kind of how I'm looking at this, is like I'm just trying to get as much base ability and strong horses in my stable for the future. So but you know, in terms of your, you know, the grandparents question, like I've had some horses like I had a horse, Kenichiwa Tim, who made it to the finals of the Buterin Bonanza here a few weeks ago. And the mom of that horse was one of these weird horses that was a strong marathoner that was bred from two sprinters in 1.0. And so I was kind of worried about that horse, but she's bred now a couple of decent marathon horses. So like, going off of very little evidence here, like I do feel like parents matter a lot more, but then you do see some other horses where maybe they kind of, it does look like they're pulling like the variants of a grandparent or something like that. So I would probably guess that there's some like RNG element that like it could pull some traits from the grandparents, but it seems like it's mostly parent to parent in, you know, from what I've, you know, what I've found.
Cool. Well, I'm looking forward to seeing as the breed cycles commence here, if we can get a little bit more information on that and figure it out.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll just all just watch BG's Twitter timeline and hopefully it tells us at some point. That's about it.
Yeah, that's all we can do. Well, hey man, thanks for joining us tonight, and best of luck in the sprint funnel with Fat Mac. And I'm sure we'll be seeing you out there on the track.
This was fun. Thanks, man. Appreciate it. Man. Awesome. All right. See ya.
All right. Well, there you have it, friends. Another Maiden stream in the books. I'm going to jump on here and see if anybody else is on Twitch so we can raid. Doesn't appear so. Looks like nobody's around. So, hey, thanks for joining us. Next 2 weeks from now is Memorial Day here in the States. So, probably not going to do a stream that day, but I don't know. Follow me on Twitter at Chateau Gaming, at Zed Chateau, and we'll figure it out. But until then, thanks for joining us, and, you know, be nice to each other.